much longer is this gonna take?
Your daughter's on the line. Just running the encryption.
Black hell!
What's up, Grim?
The data you glommed off the rig. There's no way the Georgians could have gotten this much intel without a man inside the CIA.
Fisher, you're up.
Dad?
Sarah. Hi.
Where are you?
On my way home.
I thought you were gonna call last week.
Something came up. I'm sorry.
That's all right. Were you in Georgia?
Honey, you know I can't answer that.
Yeah, I know. I was just watching it on TV. Oh!
Sarah. Sarah! Anybody have a line back to Third Echelon?
I'm here, Fisher.
What the hell's going on?
Nikoladze just declared war on the U.S.
What?
The Georgians hit our communications, transportation, power grids. We still don't know how extensive the damage is.
What's our defense? What are we doing?
What do we have? Nikoladze caught us with our pants down. All we've got is the laptop you pulled off the oil rig.
My daughter.
I know, I know. I've got people heading over there. This whole country's a mess.
I need to see Sarah.
You know what you need to do. We're helpless until we find Nikoladze. You're heading for the CIA. Your mission just became critical.
Failure at the Red Bear Army Community Hospital in Mississippi resulted in 17 deaths and over 30 injuries. Both county electricity and backup generators were destroyed, leaving military train traveling to Norfolk, Virginia, collided with a commuter rail line after an apparent failure of its automated routing system. U.S. military has not released the contents of the train's cargo, though federal authorities have evacuated a 20-mile radius surrounding the wreckage. Though no official death toll has been given, initial reports indicate the deaths of over 40 enlisted men. Potential civilian casualties are believed to be much lower.
Newspapers talking about cyber terrorism, an information crisis, information warfare. Call it what you will, but realize that no American is safe until we mobilize our army.
Rescue workers, their information grid entirely disabled, were unable to respond to the crash for nearly an hour. Injuries became fatalities as to combat Nikoladze, the Georgian president still in hiding. Though his first wave of cyber terrorism focused on military targets, intelligence proposes that a large-scale civilian target could just as easily.
We have faced terror before and triumphed. I promise here to the American people that we will triumph again. Earth is too small a place for the perpetrators of these acts to hide. The United States and her allies will enact a justice that is swift, cruel, and absolute.
CIA Headquarters, Langley, Virginia, USA. October 31st, 2004, 22:19 hours. Track down the mole in the CIA. Hours after the attack on the oil rig, Georgian President Nikoladze launched a devastating wave of remote technology-based terrorist attacks as retaliation against the US. The only lead to Nikoladze's whereabouts is a mole thought to be operating out of the Central Intelligence Agency. Greetings, fellow Earthlings, welcome back to more Tom Clancy's Splinter 7 First-Person Perspective. This mission was a little difficult, for the sake of clarity, this is a post gameplay voiceover as well, and I'm hoping it is the last one. So this mission was a little difficult primarily because of how it's completely oriented around stealth, and there's a lot of sneaking involved, sneaking and timing things. So I had to retry quite a few sections of this level until the time that I could finally manage to get it properly. They get it down properly, but yeah, it wasn't too difficult is what I want to say. Anyway, I digress. Without further ado, let's go ahead and complete this mission.
Time to get to work, Fisher. Let me reiterate. We cannot afford any casualties. The NSA doesn't operate in the US. We don't spy on other agencies.
I'm not here.
That's right. You've lost existence privileges until the mission's over. We've synced a timer on your offset to a pause in the ventilation system fans. You'll have a limited window of opportunity to use it for insertion.
So, yeah, this is a trick that I learned from one of the, you know, one of the speedruns of this game that I had watched previously, and I have to say, it's a pretty nifty trick.
What is that?
I mean, instead of, there isn't. Anyway, instead of using the, you know, going over the grill and going from above the generator, we can just, you know, simply jump over into this section. We can ramp up this pipe and jump onto the roof. And from here, we find a vent that leads us directly into the lobby of the CIA. The PS2 version, on the other hand, entirely skips this section. Like, it just starts you from, you know, the basement level. And yeah, they also have like a special scene where Sam infiltrates using a falsified ID. While it's debatable how accurate that is, because yeah, I mean, it seems more realistic that, like, as if that is how things probably would be in real life. But then again, I mean, what's unrealistic about it is the fact that, you know, it's a damn CIA and you can't just, you know, forge an ID card just like that. But then again, they are the Third Echelon, a very niche NSA initiative. So it is plausible. It is quite plausible. But, excuse me. Anyway, this is the part where, you know, you can see the flaws of the first person mod. As in, I mean, just wait for me to open this door here and you'll see what I mean. You can't exactly look at the person behind the door once you open it, because you can only see what your character sees. And that, you know, lack of that extra field of view, that makes a whole world of difference, especially in a game where you have to sneak around, where stealth is pretty much the objective. So anyway, I had to retry this specific part like a few times, like I think 4 or 5 times.
You mean when should
and
we?
This part was pretty difficult to get. I think I had to retry this like 10 to 15 times before I could finally find my way around it. But yeah, using the pipe and the pipe, like, using the shortcut saves you a lot of time. I mean, you can skip a large section of the first stage without much effort. So anyway, we're just gonna wait for this guy to head into the elevator, and then we'll pick this can up and we'll toss it anywhere. It doesn't really matter where. Because this card has a fixed patrol pattern anyway, and he's not gonna deviate from it. So he'll just go there and he'll stand there, no matter where you throw the can, that is, he'll stand there. Then he'll head to the center of the room, and we should use this opportunity to hit the button on the elevator. And yeah, then he's gonna quickly turn around and he's gonna check for a bit before he heads over into another direction. And the elevator is open, and we finally use the opportunity to quickly head in. And don't worry about him anymore, he is, you know, doing his own thing. Doesn't really matter where we are at this point. He's safely out of sight, out of mind. And that's the first stage for you. The difficult part begins now.
Just got word from our man inside. He says your F-2000's in place. You can retrieve it in the storage room behind the generator backup.
Goody.
I'd be ignorant not to arm you and keep it holstered. One agency fatality means the mission's over.
Now, what I didn't know the previous time, like, what I always have confused up until now is that you're supposed to go left first to find a door code, which is pretty deep into the level. And if you don't go left at this juncture, then, well, you're gonna have to backtrack all the way just to get that code. Which is basically 2019. It's a pretty easy code for me to remember personally, because that's when the world didn't go to shit. So, like, that was like the last year when the pandemic didn't hit, and, you know, everything was moving along so nicely, and
It's not
it just
ideal,
wasn't so much tragedy and atrocity in the vote.
Like I said, this is as tight as security gets unless Congress admits we can't run this place on pocket change.
You said it wasn't critical.
It's not. I think we can maintain.
You're sure?
I'm sure. I'm just tired.
Overtime?
I'm on hour 15.
It's a crisis, man. Crunch time.
Meaning I gotta get back to it.
I'll see you around.
Please note, there is no longer a smoking section in the cafeteria. All smoking is restricted to designated smoking terraces on the fifth floor.
And it's pretty easy to sneak by that guy, but you're gonna have problems with the next section, you know, the guy who's looking out of the balcony. Yeah, you're gonna have real problems with that guy. And sneaking past him is difficult, and I think this is also the guy, you know, I mean, we have to knock him out anyway, but I think he's looking into the server rooms. I have never, funnily enough, I've
Hello?
Never,
Turn
like,
that back on. Can I
help looked
you?
Into confirm, but yeah, I do strongly believe that this guy is the guy who's looking at the server room. And I think I have to try this section for like 12 to 15 times, but before I could finally manage to, you know, get it down right. Yeah, this is what I was talking about. I mean, you with this mod, you've got no idea how close you need to be to the other person, because if you're too close, you can bump into them. If you're too far, you can't grab them. So it's like a very fine line when you want to actually like grab somebody. So yeah, that's that. It's sort of funny how, you know, like we need to get into the server room and wait, actually no, the server room code was the room on the left. It wasn't this guy. We got the room, we got the access code for this room from this guy. Anyway, yeah. So we just wait for this guy to, you know, yeah, turn his back to us, and we sneak up behind him. I honestly do feel like this mod makes you make far less noise, not just because of this one instance, but you'll see what I mean just in a few more minutes once we head into this next room. And I always want this to be a little on the nose, you know how like the code for the next room is right in front of it, and like the computer's right there and the code for the next room is right on it. I mean, it saves time, it saves his effort, it saves us,
okay.
Saves you from pointless, you know, backtracking through different places and going to like, well, basically just, it saves you a lot of effort, but it seems a little on the nose, like,
okay.
Why even keep a computer there, why just not keep the door unlocked, but anyway, it is what it is. This is a trick which, I don't remember where I saw this trick, maybe it was from a speedrun. From the same speedrun, I mean, or maybe it was from a walkthrough made by CenterStrain01. I mean, he has got some amazing videos on Splinter, and I mean, I had always admired how smooth his gameplay is. I know a major part of the trick behind it now is the fact that he plays a console minus quick saves, and that makes it like so that, you know, it just sort of sharpens your skills anyway. And you can just literally breeze through the levels after a point. But yeah, despite that, he is pretty skilled with his walkthroughs, and they're like pretty thorough. They're a pleasure to watch. So even Conviction, I mean, I loved how the dude actually tried to finish Conviction without, you know, knocking anybody out or killing them. So yeah, that was pretty solid, in my opinion. So early in this level, Lambert calls it the F-2000, and that was pretty much the prototype weapon. That is that was an actual prototype weapon at that point. I don't know if it is an actual weapon at this point in time or not, but that was supposed to be a weapon that was being developed at that point in time. But I don't know what happened, whether it was the case that Ubisoft didn't want to pay, or maybe, oh yeah, I think these games were made by Red Storm, weren't they? Anyway, like they didn't want to pay like extra money to use the likeness or the name of the gun, or whether, you know, they didn't get permission for it, but they changed it into SC20K. So we're just gonna wait for this guy to turn around, and now we're clear to go. Just to be safe, I decide to wait a little and wait for this guy to turn back around so that he doesn't catch me slipping into this room. I mean, this level has some pretty intense moments where you need to, you know, carefully sneak about. Typically I would go in through the left, through the door on the left, but since I am playing, you know, this game as a tactical shooter, I decided to knock these people out and infiltrate my way through the room on the right instead. And if you take a look at the balcony right in front of us, it sort of looks like the same office where we knocked the guy out. You know, the guy from whom we got the door code for, that room with a lot of radios and transistor thingies. I don't know what room that was, but anyway. I tried to hit him with an airfall ring round, but I missed. I was about to use the sticky cam for the knockout, but then I remembered, you know what? Let's just play it safe and use the sticky shotgun instead. So here I was trying to figure out how to, get out of the view mode, the camera mode. And now it's time for the cleanup. This is one of the things about this game which, irks me a little, and more or less just promotes me to play the game in a more, sneaky, stealthy fashion, if you will, because like, chaos theory onwards, what happened was these people, these bodies were only detected if some enemy AI walked into them, actually found them, knocked out. But in the original Splinter Cell, that is this game, and in Pandora Tomorrow, as long as the bodies were not in the shadows, the computer, as soon as you moved on to the next stage, right, or the next section of the map, the computer would just do like a sweep of the area.
The leak is a low security PC registered to one Mitchel Dougherty.
Great. Dougherty's PC is your new objective, Fisher. I'll upload the details to your opsat.
It would scan the area for bodies, and if it found any that were not in the shadows, it would trigger an alarm. These games do that, so it's a way to implement things, but I'm not exactly the biggest fan of it. So we came to the CIA to figure out who the mole was, if there was a mole, and it turns out that this is a guy called Dougherty, whose PC has all these leaks. The data from whose PC we're getting all this data, all this leaked data. I probably could have made a run for it while this guy was busy looking at the TV screens or whatever on the right, but I decided to play it safe and just wait it out anyway. Yeah. You can see how fast I'm actually moving and how little noise I'm making in the process. And these are the kind of things which actually have me convinced that this mod actually makes your footsteps make less noise. The same thing with, the way I instantly dropped from the tower in the server room, from the shelf. And did you see that guy look at us?
Due to recent events, all security personnel remain at level 3. free patrol.
Sometimes if the guards get close to you, they'll look right at you. Not even in your general direction, right at you. As if they know you're there, but they're just choosing to ignore you. I mean, of course, the in-game lore could be that, you know, like, a good explanation, rather, I mean, could be the fact that they think that something's there, but they're not convinced completely, so they decide to, you know, like, just let things go. Right now, I'm waiting for a guy to return, because I have tried this specific section, like, 6 or 7 times, and, yeah, this guy always shows up and catches me red-handed. What I want to do at this point here is basically cause a distraction. I could shoot this guy out, of course, like I could just knock this guy out, but yeah, that is what I attempted to do. I knocked this guy out, but there's some magical force field right in front of you know, this guy. Maybe this guy is Neo, maybe this guy is, you know, a Jedi, but Sticky Cam just gets stuck on nothing. And, well, on the bright side, it gives me, you know, the opportunity I needed to infiltrate my way past him. Now, this section had my fantasies in a bunch. I'm not gonna lie, this section sucked. Primarily because of how you need to time your movements with the cameras, and given the limited field of view with this mod, it was a task which was very difficult to pull off. But I finally figured out, even though it does not look like it, but I finally figured out that the area right along the wall here, right along the line, the wall with the elevators, it has got barely enough shadow to, you know, keep you hidden. So you don't actually need to, you know, time your movements at all. You can just stick to the walls. I mean, you don't even need to, like, stick to the walls. You can just, you know, stay right by them and keep moving. And I'm basically taking this process slow and tediously because I'm just trying to play it safe. But as you can see from the light meter, there's no cause for concern at all. You are sufficiently within the shadows to not alert anyone. And this next section is also a little bit of a doozy, primarily because, you know, as soon as you move here, this guy turns around to take a look at, you know, whatever he takes a look at, and you just need to stick to this shadow. The problem is, if you don't time it well enough, the guy at the other end, he can sometimes see you. Part of me is also convinced that people can see you less with this mod, because I think typically that guy probably would have noticed me. But he did not seem to do that. And I pulled out my gun to shoot the camera, then I realized, wait, this camera is bulletproof. These, you know, square cameras, they're the bulletproof ones. So, too bad that there's a light which isn't bulletproof. This next section took me a few tries as well. Primarily because of how okay, two things here. I always found it strange how this, you know, how this door has the same code as the room with, you know, anything they haven't shown yet, get back before they do. The generator power backup room.
I don't know. I don't care.
Or is it the same? I don't know. I think it's a similar code. It's a 6-digit code starting with 110. But at any rate, yeah. Like, without the third person perspective, it's nigh impossible to tell what that guy's doing and whether he's looking this way or that. And I sort of got lucky here when I did, after, you know, a lot of trial and error. This guy wasn't looking my way, so I could actually, like, pretty easily cross over to the other end. Yeah. So, I think even in my previous playthrough that I posted on YouTube, I accidentally show myself to this guy and I have to like evade him by running around the pillars. And this guy actually follows me down into the elevator as well. The elevator area, I mean. So, yeah, I mean, it was a little stressful back then. But yeah, that's that with this section. We just head over into the elevator. Oh wait, we gotta pick this lock first. Maybe that's why I think this lockpick scenario is more of a, you know, safeguard against you having, you know, just run through the entire level. Or maybe it's like a way to promote you to play more stealthily, clear the previous section better, I suppose. But anyway, that's that for this stage, and now we're moving on to the third and final stage of this level, which is kidnapping Dougherty.
He's in information retrieval, office 508.
What do I do with Dougherty?
Stay out of his way for now. We'll get back to you when we find more on him.
Found traces of the media in a secure data forwarding service in Holland. Another in Bangkok, three in Canada.
Any order?
Nope.
Take it back. Turn up the volume.
The foolish avarice and arrogance of a nation that still believes there is such a thing as a world superpower.
Take it back to beliefs?
What, the chain sound?
Of a nation that still believes there is...
So right now, they're slowly figuring out how, you know... See the moaning sound? Yeah, that's actually a cow mooing. And yeah, they're slowly figuring it out how Nikoladze is hidden in a Singapore, you know, in an abattoir in Singapore. Or was it Malaysia? I forgot. Probably Malaysia. Anyway, that's Dougherty, and we need to just stab into his computer first.
Great work, Fisher. How are we doing, Grim?
Working on it. Very clever back door. Looks like Philip Mass's work. Bouncing to a server. Surf Kalina underscore VA, which is the Kalinatech building in... Oh, black hell, somebody spotted me. I shut down.
We'll call back. Fisher, we're gonna need you to bag Dougherty.
What happened with Grim's daughter?
We'll worry about that. You worry about Dougherty. Wait for him to take a smoke break. It'll make grabbing him easier. Details on your offset.
It's creepy how Lambert even knows, you know, you down to every little personal habit and detail of yours. Like, how do you know that Dougherty takes a smoke break? How do you know he smokes? How do you know when he goes for a smoke break? How often he goes for a smoke break? Like,
meaning we have three points of attack. Two transformers coming
Central Intelligence, man. I mean, he's not even the Central Intelligence Agency.
Agent Marks has been trying to sell us on the idea of electrostatic fuel bombs, but the blast radius doesn't figure.
At this point in time here, they're trying to figure out
archival system 70 hours earlier.
What actually caused the blackout?
On the 28th of October, effectively wiped out our.
Of course, in the next video, we're going to find out it's actually a.
Do know how they gained access to the transformers. These are hospital security.
I wouldn't call it a virus. I mean,
hospital directors and us.
They are sort of viruses, but not exactly, you know, virus program.
Yeah,
it's like an entire kernel.
Hold on,
an infinite state machine.
Be a few minutes
the mass kernels. But anyway.
All right, I'm back.
So, yeah, this is what I was saying back then, you know? I told you guys about how it's difficult. Difficult to tell what you're interacting with in the first person, because you can't see what you're interacting with, and you need to be, you know, right in its face, or keep it right in your face to actually interact with it. But, yeah. Anyway, that's Dougherty right there. And this guy sure moves slow. like pretty damn slow. Another thing I like about this, you know, older title is that there's a limit to how far they can notice you from, because in chaos theory, if the opportunity provided it to be so, people could literally spot you from across the entire map. Some glitches actually made it happen, but with this game there's like a specific range or distance up until which the enemies could see. They could not see anywhere beyond that, and that is something which I can honestly appreciate about this game, because otherwise things would have been so ugly. So right here I try something from one of the later levels of the game. If you've played the game before, you already know how in Chinese embassy the digits on the number pad, they, you know, get warm and light up under the thermal. But I guess Langley doesn't like to use air conditioning inside of their agencies. Anyway, so this is Dougherty taking a smoke break.
They've got a disappearance truck parked in the back.
How the hell did that happen?
So, since this game is, since this mod is about, you know, turning this into a tactical shooter, and this level is about avoiding all tactical shootouts, thankfully we've got reusable ammo in the form of a sticky cam, which I am using quite relentlessly, and something which I, you know, completely forget to pick up here at this juncture. So I will pick up Dougherty, and then I will remember, oh wait, I need to grab my sticky cam. Thankfully I did, because I couldn't have, you know, cleared the next section without it. Well, I probably could have, that's probably a lie. I could have done that using, you know, old school hand-to-hand combat, but I mean, it's unfair to call it combat, it's just getting the drop on somebody and choking them out. But I mean, in this game I guess Sam doesn't even choke them out, I mean he just literally whips them up top their head with his pistol. But anyway, you get the point. Which is something very curious. I mean, I haven't tried it thus far with this level, or I think I have, but in this specific level, Sam does not have his pistol. What does he use to hit people so that they get knocked out? Because as far as I remember, he has got only one animation. I need to go back to CIHQ, minus this mod, and check out what it does.
How were they spotted?
They weren't hiding. NSA presence on Langley is completely legit.
The only problem is me and Dougherty.
Right. A SIGINT ninja with an unconscious bureaucrat on his shoulder is less than copacetic, so don't let him see.
Who's there?
So what really surprised me at this juncture was how, you know, I'm walking down the stairs. Of course I'm not crouching, but they heard me, which is something that I found rather strange, given how this mod has otherwise made my footsteps practically, you know, noiseless otherwise. So at this point I'm just waiting for this guy, and as it turns out, even though you can lock people out with the sticky cam, it is not the best weapon for doing so, because as you'll see right here, the camera goes all the way to his head but somehow bounces off it, and it somehow comes back and falls on the foot of the stairs. I didn't know how that worked. I don't know how that happened. But anyway, it is what it is.
This isn't happening.
I pick up the sticky camera, and yeah, I guess this guy saw me. But at any rate, I mean, it was pretty easy to dispose of him. Didn't exactly count as an alarm or anything of that nature either. So yeah, I'm thankful for that. Just look at how pretty the lighting looks in this game. I mean, despite the fact that the graphics are like so old and basic, I mean, the lighting just looks so gorgeous. And I don't know, I mean, of course the mod does, you know, DG Voodoo does play a huge part in it, but My god, I mean... I just can't imagine lighting looking so pretty for a game that was literally made in 2002. But here we are. Here we are. So I was pretty thankful for the extra sticky shocker that we got from there. And it wasn't before this playthrough that I realized that we actually have a ladder which we can use to, you know, we'll basically run down to the ground level and come back up to the balcony here. Because that would have made things very convenient. It does make things very convenient. And it would have if I had known about it before. So I think I accidentally pressed the equip key here, and it sort of reminded me of how cool it looks, you know, whenever you're carrying a body and you just press the equip key, Sam just shrugs off whatever he's carrying, like, you know, dead weight, like a piece of clothing, and yeah, I mean, it's one of the cooler animations in the game. Of all the shadows there, I don't know why, but I decide to go hide him inside. Well, whatever works for me, I guess. And apparently I wasn't, you know, quite satisfied with this spot either, as I think I decided to move him further in because of how he was glowing. Oh, well. What I am truly curious about, though, is how they managed the, you know, light and shadow detection system of this game. Whether it's all, you know, just baked global data, like baked global illumination data, or whether, you know, there is some actual algorithm involved here about how much light you're receiving or you're not receiving, or, you know, how much in the shadow you truly are. But I'm utterly fascinated with how they implemented the system. Because in some of the cases, the lights are actually dynamic. And, I mean, I know Unreal Engine has always been, like, cutting edge, and they had been using a modified version of the same for, in order to make these games. But it would be truly, you know, something I would consider truly revolutionary, especially for 2002 or even 2000s, if they could, like, manage to add such a feature in Unreal Engine itself, where you can actually detect whether you're in the light or in the shadows. So yeah, I mean, that's pretty amazing. And this wasn't even the first game that did this. I mean, this ladder that I was talking about, by the way.
You mean you actually deal with humans sometimes?
I think the first game that did this was Thief, and I'm utterly fascinated about. Fascinated with how they achieved that in that game as well, because I think the first Thief game came out in either 1999 or 98, if I'm not wrong.
There's no such thing as a truth serum, but barbiturates are pretty good.
What, like reds, blues? What's that stuff? Pinto something?
Pentobarbital? That's a good one. Of course, people,
you're doing alright?
So, yeah, I was just having a little bit of fun there. And well, basically just I guess Sam just uses his fist to, you know, bonk them on the head. Anyway, yeah, I was just having being a little cheeky there, and just waiting for the guy to, you know, like, just standing behind the guy, breathing down his neck without him ever finding out about us. Yeah, so I mean, while the lighting looks pretty, and I mean, this part of the level is comparatively pretty, especially with the rain, what I really find tedious about this section is the fact that you have to lug Dougherty around. I mean, it probably would have been more pleasurable if it was an actual escort mission instead, even though, I mean, that's I understand how you can never. I mean, that's pretty difficult to put in a Splinter Cell mission, even though, in a Splinter Cell game, even though Pandora Tomorrow did just that. But, yeah. Huh. I mean, this section is probably the most tedious section of the entire game. I kid you not. Despite how pleasurable the mission is. No, that actually makes me curious. Whether, you know, if you wait long enough,
pleased to meet you.
And that must be Dougherty.
The guy actually goes away.
Tell you about
and you
Sarah?
Need to
no.
She's fine.
Knock him
Blackout
out.
Spooked her, but she's completely all right.
And that's the end of the mission for
emotional.
Us. Let's over, head over into the debriefing now. CIA Headquarters, Langley, Virginia, USA, November 1st, 2004, 0059 hours. Interrogation of Mitchel Dougherty reveals a compulsive disorder that moved him to hoard data on an insecure computer, thereby allowing an intelligence leak. Grim Sortier traces the leak to nearby offices of Galena Tech. During the process, her intrusion is detected, necessitating an emergency infiltration of Galena Tech. Well, I mean, to be honest, you are supposed to be smart enough to not, hoard sensitive government information on private servers like this guy is doing, like Dougherty is doing. I also feel bad for the poor guy because he got like interrogated and tortured for the heck of it. I mean, if he hadn't done that, then he wouldn't have been needlessly, tortured and put through all that pain. But I guess some people, for some people it is what it is. I mean, it's unfortunate that it had to happen, but I guess maybe he can find better luck, maybe he'll learn a lesson through this. Anyway, the next mission will be featuring Galena Tech, and I hope it will be a live voiceover, until that time, see you later, take care, farewell fellow Earthlings.